Welcome to the lectures on building materials. In today's lecture, we will learn about the glasses. So first of all, we will see what is the glass. What does glass mean? The glass is an amorphous material. Amorphous means it is formless material. Or to say it is non-crystallized material. That's why it is hard. It is brittle. Brittle means it is weak in tension. It is transparent. As well as it is super cool material, which has almost infinite viscosity. It doesn't have any particular any definite melting point. It can be obtained by diffusing a mixture of number of metallic silicates or the borates of the sodium, potassium, calcium and lead. As we have discussed that it does not have any particular or any specific melting point. It softens over a temperature range. Mechanical properties of glasses. The few mechanical properties of the glasses are listed here. What are those? The first one is amorphous. As we have discussed that. What is the meaning of amorphous? That amorphous means that glass is a formless material. It is non-crystalline material. Then it is a brittle material. That means it is the glass is weak in tension. If you apply the tension force over it, it will not sustain too much tension force and it will break early just because of the tensile stresses. It is transparent, what to say, it is translucent. Then the glass, it is a good electric insulator. Then it is unaffected by air as well as water, acid or by some other chemical reagents. It does not have any crystalline structure. That means it has high compressive strength. Then it can absorb, transmit and it can reflect the light also. Then there are the raw materials which are used in manufacturing of glasses. The first one is sodium. We use the sodium as Na2CO3. We use as a raw material in the manufacturing of glasses, particularly for the manufacturing of the soft glasses. Then we use the potassium as K2CO3. It is double potassium we use as a raw material in the manufacturing of the hard glasses. Similarly, we have the calcium as limestone, chalk and lime. Then the lead as the first or the red lead is used in the filled glasses. Then we have some more raw materials like silica, quartz, white sand and ignited flint. In zinc, that is zinc oxide, we use in heat and shock proof glasses. And we have borax, and the boric acid as heat and shock proof glasses. If you want to use this kind of glasses, then we have to, heat and shock proof glasses, then we have to use the borax. As well as in cullets, cullets are nothing but they are the broken glasses, or this is the best glasses which I use to increase the usability during the manufacturing of glasses. Then we have this flowchart shows the manufacturing process of glass. These are the some of the steps which are involved in the manufacturing of glass. Those are, the first one is melting, then we have the forming and shaping, then annealing and finishing. From here we can see that first of all raw material is taken, it is mixed. After mixing of raw material, the cullet is also mixed in it. Then cullet is mixed with the raw materials. Then the melting is done. After melting, the forming and shaping is done. After forming and shaping, it passes from the annealing process. After annealing, the cutting of the glass as per the requirement, then inspection, packing and delivery. So first of all, we will see what we do in the melting process. In the melting process, the raw materials in the proper proportions are mixed, and after the mixing, we generally mix the cullets also in that mix, and we again to go for the mixing of the raw materials with the cullets. This mixture is nothing but it is divided into finely chopped powder, which is this intimate mixture is called the batch. It is fused in a furnace at very high temperature, near about 1900 degrees centigrade. This charge melts and fuses into a viscous fluid these are some of the chemical reactions which takes place during the melting. That is calcium carbonate CaCl3 plus SiO2, then we get the CaSiO3 plus CO2. The CO2 removes after this. Then this is sodium bicarbonate Na2CO3 plus SiO2. We get Na2SiO3 plus there will be formation of carbon dioxide which will be removed. So during this melting, the CO2 generates, that is carbon dioxide generates. This this carbon dioxide will be will removed from this material. During the removal of this CO2, this will leave some traces over the material. So to remove or to come over these kind of problems, we generally added the MnO2, manganese oxide, and then heating is continued till we get the clear molten mass that is free from bubbles. And it is after that it is cooled to a temperature of 800 degree centigrade. After the melting, the next step is forming and shaping. In the forming and shaping, the viscous mass obtained from the melting is poured into the molds, into different size of molds, the size which is required as per the requirement. The obtained the viscous mass is poured into those molds, and then it passes under the blowing or the pressing between the rollers to get the particular shapes. Even after this forming and shaping, the temperature of this viscous fluid is used to be somewhere around 800 degrees centigrade. During annealing process, it allows the gradual loss in temperature. So, just to achieve this gradual loss in temperature, this viscous mass of the glass passes through various chambers where the temperature reduces in a gradually, so that there will be gradual loss in temperature. So it will allow the cooling of glass material. Why we prefer this? If there will be sudden change in temperature, there will be a temperature strain, and as the temperature strain will cause the temperature stresses, and there will be chances of formation of the cracks within the glass. So that's why we want the gradual change in the temperature, so that there will be no temperature stress, and we can get a proper uniform the glass material. So that's why this glass material, which is after forming and shaping, it passes from the various chambers where the temperature reduces in a uniformly, and so it reduces the internal strain in the glass. After annealing, the final step is the finishing. In the finishing, the finishing is the last step of glass manufacturing. It involves these following steps, that is cleaning, grinding, polishing and cutting in the required sizes. Then we have several types of glasses. Out of that, the first one we will discuss, that is soda lime glass. This soda lime glass is also known as the soft glasses. What it has in this, about 90% of glasses is soda lime glasses. Those are made with silica, that is sand, calcium carbonate, and the soda ash. The soda ash is the material which makes this different. That is soda lime or the soft glass. The approximate composition of this kind of glass, that is soda glass, is Na2CO3, CaO6, SiO2. They are the low cost material. They are resistant to water but not to the acids. They can melt easily, hence can be hot worked. Where we can use the soda lime glasses? The soda lime glass can be used for the window glasses. We can use it for the electric bulbs. We can use it for plate glasses, plate glass. We can use it for bottles, jars, as well as test tube, reagent bottles. It is for these purposes we can use this soft glass. Then we have next one, potash lime or the hard glass. The potash lime glass is also known as the hard glass. This potash lime glass is made from silica, calcium carbonate and potassium carbonate. Here we are using the three other raw materials, that is silica, calcium carbonate and potassium carbonate. While in the previous one, that was the soft glass, we were using silica and calcium carbonate was same, but in place of potassium carbonate we were using the soda ash, while in this we are using the potassium carbonate. This is the approximate composition of the hard glass, that is K2CO3, CaO6, SiO2. it possesses the high melting point and therefore fuses with the difficulty. Where we can use this hard glass, we can use it for the chemical apparatus, combustion tubes, glassware, which are used for heating operation. And this hard glass, that is potash lined glass, is costlier than the soft glass. This is 96% silica glass. It contains 96% silica, 3% B2O3. So if we add to both the things, it will be 99%. Rest of all 1% is stresses of other material, that is like cullets and some other material which is required for fusion. It is transparent and the coefficient of thermal expansion is very low, hence they are very resistant to the thermal shocks. Just because of their temperature, as they are the thermal expansion is very less, the temperature strain very less, and the temperature stresses will also be very less. Hence, they are very resistant to the thermal shocks, and as well as they are having high chemical resistance to the corrosive agents. We have several uses of this 96% silica glass. What are those? They can be used where high temperature resistance is required. They can resist up to 800 degrees centigrade. They are also used in the construction of chemical plants, laboratory, crucibles, induction furnace, lining and electrical insulator. These are the places where high resistance is required against the thermal shocks. And this 96% silica glass provides the high thermal shocks against, high resistance against the thermal shocks. Hence, it can be used for these purposes. Then we have 99.5% silica glass. Here it contains purely silica. It is heated up to its melting point. It is transparent again. The coefficient thermal expansion is very low. It is even comparatively much more low as compared to 96% silica glass. Hence it has much more higher resistance against the thermal shocks as compared to the 96% silica glass. This is obviously, this 99.5% silica glass, this is costlier than the 96% silica glass. Hence, this can be used for the construction of chemical plants, laboratory crucibles, induction of furnace linings, electrical insulator, heater, and very high light transmission properties. And the next is safety glass. This is made by fusing two to three flat sheets of the glasses, and in between them the alternate thin layers of vinyl plastic is introduced where it is capped. It is heated where both the layers merge together and glass is toughened. That means what we are doing, we are keeping two layers of glass, and in between that we are keeping one layer of this vinyl plastic, and these are heated up to a certain temperature so that into the heat the both will start melting little bit, hence these two units will get converted into one single unit only. So what are the uses of this safety glass? It is used as a windshield in the automobiles and the airplanes. On the breaking of these, the pieces does not fly apart just because of the presence of plastic layer in between that holds the both the layers, and just because of this, after breaking, the parts does not fly. Then next is wire glasses. The wire glasses does not fall apart into splinters when they are broken, when they are breaks, and it is fire resistant. This is also similar as the previous and safety glass. Here also, whenever they splinters or they break, the wire, this holds the glass sheets, and this does not allow the splinters of the broken pieces of glass. Where we can use this? We can use this wire glasses as a fire resistant doors, roofs, skylights and the windows. For these purposes, we can use the wire glasses. And we have laminated glass. These sheets of glass fiber or the glass holes are soaked in a solution of thermosetting plastic like phenol, formaldehyde, resins, and then placed one over the other. Then they are cured under a strong as steam. This is non-flammable and insulating material. In vinyl resins, they are added into the alternate layers. Where we can use this laminated glass, we can use this as shutter, we can use a shock and bulletproof glasses. Then this is insulating glass. Two or more plates of the glass are filled with dehydrated air and then edges are sealed airtightly. So they did not allow the they did not allow to pass the heat from one side to another side. So they provide the thermal insulating, and so house remains cool in the summer and warm in winter, because they do not they work as insulator. They does not allow the transmission of the heat from one side to another side. Strengthening of glasses. The strengthening of glasses can be done into three stages. The first stage is tempering, then thermal strengthening, and then chemical strengthening. There are three stages which are required for the strengthening of glasses. Now we will move towards the masonry construction. What does the masonry construction means? Masonry is the building structure from the individual units laid in and bonded together with the help of mortar. So what are the individual units? The individual units can be the brick, it can be stone, it can be marble, it can be granite, it can be limestone, it can be concrete blocks, it can be glass blocks. These are the individual units which are laid and they are bonded with the help of mortar. We can use any kind of mortar, like cement mortar, it can be lime mortar, it can be a fire resistant mortar, it can be a mud mortar, it can be lightweight mortar. Depends upon the proper suitable combination. So what is the masonry construction? The masonry construction is nothing but the building structure of individual units laid in the and they are bound together with the help of mortar. The term masonry can also refer to the units themselves. The common material in the masonry constructions are bricks, stone, marble, granite, limestone, concrete block, glass blocks, etc. This is generally a highly durable form of construction. We have several advantages of the masonry constructions. What are those? The uses of materials such as bricks and stone can increase the thermal masses, because they are the materials such as bricks and stones are fire resistant material, and if we use as these materials for the construction of masonry, and then definitely it will increase its thermal mass, and hence it can protect the building from the fire. So this is one of the advantages of masonry construction. If you will use the bricks and stone as a unique material. Most types of masonry typical will not require the painting, and hence can provide a structure with reduced life cycle cost. That means it will be economical to use to adopt that kind of masonry. For example, the ashlar masonry. The ashlar masonry is a type of stone masonry in which we use the square or rectangular shape of stone for the construction. It is very the outlook appearance is very good of the ashlar masonry, and it does not require the painting over it. So it definitely this will not require the painting. The cost of the masonry construction will reduce, as it does not require the painting, and hence the life cycle cost will also reduce, will also come down. Then masonry is a non-combustible material, product. The masonry walls are more resistant to the projectiles such as debris from earthquake, hurricanes and tornadoes. It has certain strength to reduce the effect due to these natural hazards. Then the masonry structure built in compression, preferably with the lime mortar, can have a useful life of more than 500 years as compared to 30 to 100 years of structure of steel or reinforced structure. Every material or every kind of system which has certain advantages, it definitely has certain limitations. Here the masonry construction also has certain limitations. We have mainly two limitations under this masonry construction. What are those? It is extreme weather combination with the right circumstances can cause the degradation of masonry walls due to the frost damage. Then the masonry tends to be very heavy and it has its deadlock as well as live lock. So the proper strong foundation is always needed. If the masonry is done or building is constructed over a weak foundation, then there will be problem of settlement of the building, or that will cause the cracking, and or to say it will reduce the durability of the structure. classification of masonry. We have different types of masonry. First of all, we will see about the stone masonry. In this stone masonry, what is stone masonry? The masonry composed of field, quarried or the cast stone as a unit material, which will be followed by or which will be bounded by the mortar. Here it can be a lime mortar, it can be a cement mortar. So in the stone masonry, we have one is ashlar stone masonry, then we have rubble stone masonry, then we have one more polygonal stone masonry, and we have the rubble stone and we have flint masonry. Under this rubble stone masonry, we have two more types, that is coarse rubble masonry and coarse rubble masonry also. In the ashlar stone masonry, what we do here, what it has, then this, the stones which are used for this particular stone masonry are used to be of rectangular shape, or it used to be a the square shape, which are bonded with the mortar. While in the rubble stone masonry, the stone produced from the quarry are directly used. They can be of rectangular shape or they can be dressed up to certain degree. This is the rubble stone masonry. We can have, this is one of the picture we have, this which is representing the rubble masonry. We can see the stones which are used for this are used to be of irregular shapes. You can see this is the, this picture is representing the ashlar masonry, in which you can see some of the square shape stone, while some of the rectangular shape of stones are used for the masonry construction. As we have discussed, the appearance of the ashlar stone masonry is too good. We can see the rectangular as well as the stone square shape, the square shape stones are used. This the appearance is improved too much. This is again one of the example of ashlar stone masonry. You can see these square shape stone, rectangular, rectangular. The combination of square and rectangular shape stones are used. Then the rubble masonry, as we have discussed, under the rubble masonry we have two more types, that is coarse rubble masonry and the uncoarse rubble masonry. What is this coarse rubble masonry? In this, the coarse rubbles are carried out in one course. Such that the stone legs are generally of equal height. While in case of uncoarse rubble masonry, the stones are used directly or which are directly received from the quarry. They are not of same height. So whatever is regular shape and regular size of stone, whatever we are receiving from the quarry, they are directly used for the construction of the stone masonry. And the spaces in between them are generally filled with the stone chips. The joints are about 12 mm in this uncoarse rubble masonry. So what we are saying in coarse masonry, we are saying that they are carried out in one course, and height and of the stone laid in one course used to be of equal. So we are saying this is one, this is the height of one course, that's the edge. So these stones will be dressed in a proper way. They will be almost on the same size. And the spaces in between these stones will be filled with the help of chips. Similarly, there will be another course, and again the stones of almost same height will be laid here. And again the spaces in between them will be filled with the help of the stone chips. So this is the coarse masonry. While in case of uncoarse rubble masonry, whatever stone we will receive directly from the site will be used directly. Means the stones of irregular shape will be used directly, and the spaces in between them will be filled with the help of stone chips. There will be no coarse layer. There will be no coarse height. Suppose this is what we got from. This is uncoarse rubble masonry. This can be clear from the help of this picture. We can see this is the coarse rubble masonry. We can see the height of one course is almost same, and the spaces in between them is filled with the help of the chips. This is uncoarse rubble masonry. You can see whatever irregular shapes of the stone, whatever we have received from the quarry, is directly used here, and the spaces is filled with the help of stone chips. There is no coarse height. Well, this is, it represents polygonal rubble masonry. This is the flint masonry. We have some more type of masonry construction. There is one more, that is the glass unit masonry. This is a non-load bearing structure. This is non-load bearing masonry. Means it is generally used under the framed structure for the outside face, for the outside wall face, or to improve the to improve the appearance. We generally use this glass unit masonry. Generally in the mall we can see this kind of the outside faces there, where the glasses are generally fixed directly with the help of mortars. They are the plain masonry. They are the masonry in which the tensile resistance of the masonry is taken into consideration, and the effects of the stresses in reinforcement are neglected. While in the reinforcement masonry, the masonry construction in which the reinforcement acting in the connection with the masonry is used to resist the forces. We can understand this reinforcement masonry with the help of some sketches. You can see this is the one layer of masonry. We can say this can be reinforced block masonry, or it can be a strong masonry where there is a space in between two layers which is filled with the concrete, and some horizontal reinforcement is provided. Here we can see this is the two layers of masonry. This is the space in between them which is provided with the reinforcement. We can fill the concrete also in between this area. This picture clears. This picture much more. You can see this is one layer of brick masonry. This is another layer of brick masonry. In between this, the reinforcement is provided, as well as it is filled with the concrete. Then we have two types of joints, that is control joints and the expansion joints. Generally in the concrete or like the brick masonry, there will be change in the dimension of this masonry because of change in temperature and humidity. Due to change in temperature, there will be expansion as well as there will be contraction. Just because of that, there will be change in the dimension. So this expansion and contraction causes the development of cracks in the masonry. Hence, therefore, to avoid the cracks because of this contraction and expansion, we provide the expansion and control joints. So it allows the expansion and contraction of the wall, contraction of the masonry due to change in temperature. Now we'll discuss about the brick masonry. What is brick masonry? The laying of bricks bonded together with the help of mortar. Here's what which mortar we use. Generally we prefer the cement mortar in this brick masonry. So these bricks are bonded together with the help of cement mortar. So this kind of masonry is called the brick masonry. We have two types of bricks. One is modular brick, another one is conventional bricks. Generally we prefer, we use for the construction this modular bricks. This is the standard brick. The size of the standard bricks is 19 cm by 9 cm by 9 cm. While the size of these conventional bricks are 23 cm by 11.4 cm by 7.5 cm. Here let's learn about some of the basic term that is header. The face of the brick, which is this 9 cm by 9 cm, the square faces, this face is generally known as the header in a brick. Here the another is structure. This face, which is this longer face, that is 19 cm, and this one that is shorter face, that is 9 cm. So there are this face or this side. This side of the brick is generally known as the structure. Then we have some of the closures. The first one is pin closure. This is the header face. At the midpoint of this and midpoint of this, if this will be cut down, if this brick will be cut down from this, and the left out portion will be called the king closure. What is the closure? After dividing, after cutting a brick, whatever portion is left out, or whatever face is left out, that face is called the closure. So this is the king closure. It is there at the mid of this 9 cm, this is also 9 cm. This is the midpoint of this, and midpoint of this are joined, and the brick is split along this plane. Then this face or this closure will be called the king closure. Then we have clean closure. In clean closure, what to do? This is 9 cm face. In this 9 cm, the midpoint of this, and this is the longer face, the midpoint of this, they are joined together, and there will be cut made through this plane. Then the closure which will be formed, that is called the clean closure. Now we can understand it more clearly. We can see this was the midpoint of this shorter face, that is 9 cm. This was the midpoint of this longer face, and a cut is made along this plane. This face will be called the clean closure. Then we have mitre. From this end, a plane or a section will be drawn at a 45 degree to 60 degree. After that, a closure which will be made, that is called mitre closure. You can see it. This face will be called the mitre closure. This angle can vary from 45 degree to 60 degree. Then we have mobile closure. This point will be matched with the midpoint of this shorter face, and a cut which will be made along this plane, that will cause this mobile closure. You can see from here this face. This will be the mobile closure. And this is bed, half bed. What we are doing, this is the longer face, the midpoint of this and midpoint of this. If the break will be split along this plane, then it will be called half bed. Now it is more clear. This face is called, or this closure is called half bed, or this bed is called half bed. Then next we have 3/4. That means 3/4 of this longer face, 3/4 of this point, and when the cut is made along this, this is back 3/4. It is more clear now. Then we have types of bonds in the masonry construction. But in this brick masonry, we have four types of bonds. One is structure bond, then we have header bond, then English bond and the climate bond. First of all, we will learn about this stretcher bond. You can see here, this is stretcher bond. In this, all the bricks are laid as a stretcher on the faces of wall. This space we have already done. This space is known as the stretcher, which is the longer face. This is 19 cm, this is 9 cm. This face is generally known as the stretcher. This brick, this stretcher brick are laid as a stretcher on the faces of wall. This is the face of wall. This is the stretcher. Here we can see. This is the short, this is the header. This is stretcher. This stretcher are laid on the faces of wall. The thickness of this wall is half brick, that is 9 cm. So these walls, these are used for the walls where the half brick thickness is required. Where generally, in which kinds of wall the half brick thickness is required? Generally, the partition wall, in the sleeper walls, or in the division walls, like that is chimney stack. There, the half brick thickness is required. So in this kind of wall is required, we generally prefer the stretcher bond. Here we can see these are the stretcher which is laid, the bricks which are laid as a stretcher on the faces of wall. And the next is header bond. Here the headers, bricks are laid as headers on the faces of walls. We have learned that this shorter face, that is 9 cm by 9 cm, this face is called as header. So this pattern is used when thickness of wall is equal to one brick, that is 19 cm. This is the header, so this is stretcher. So this will be the thickness of wall. This is the header, this is the stretcher face, so this will be the thickness of wall, that is 19 cm. So after using concrete, the thickness of this wall will get converted to 20 cm, that will be equivalent to one brick thickness. Hence these are used where one thickness of wall is equal to one brick. And here overlap is kept of half brick. We can see this is the overlap, the half of this header, that is half of this 9 cm, this side half of 9 cm, this side. So we are saying that overlap is kept half of brick width, that is 9 cm. And then we have next the English bond. They are most commonly used in the wall construction. It has the alternate layers of the stretcher and the headers. We can see this layer is of stretcher, where bricks are laid as a stretcher on the face of wall. This is the stretcher, this is the stretcher, this is the stretcher, this is the stretcher. While the next layer is having all the headers, where bricks are laid as headers on the faces of walls. Header, 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 header. And again, another layer is of where bricks are laid as stretcher on the face of wall. So, in this English bond, it has the alternate layers of stretcher and header. This board, this is most commonly used in the wall construction and is considered as the strongest type of bond. Next we have the Flemish bond. Here we can see in this each layer has the alternate header and stretcher. First we have the stretcher, and this is the header, which is the square shaped face. This is the longer face of the brick. So each and every layer has the alternate header and stretcher. This is the stretcher, this is the header. Again stretcher, this is the header. And a union header is placed next to the union header. This is a union header. After that, one union header is placed in the every alternate post to form the face cap. Here this is another alternate layer. Again we have kept it. This union header. There is one difference in the English bond and this Flemish bond, that in English bond, one layer was of stretcher bond, that is one layer was full of stretcher, another layer of header, and another layer of structure. While in this Flemish, one layer itself consists of alternate structure and head. So this is about the ponds. Thank you.